Hi, I'm Barry Norman, and I'm on Misery Point Radio. What are you on?
Minions, thanks for joining me again on Misery Point Radio. Not gonna lie, I was getting a little lonely and depressed, thinking that I'd lost you forever. But no, here we are, together, again. I'm at a loss for words. I will spare you my true feelings, though, because nobody needs that level of emotional diarrhea. But what I can provide you is a 100% pure, uncut, unadulterated, unsanitized entertainment enema. You don't have to thank me. I'm totally happy to purge you of all your impurities. Well, now that we've established my new role in the universe, let's talk about today's guest, who is probably writing a letter of termination to his agent right about now. But that's all right. Who needs agents? I mean, I don't have one, and look at me. All right, no, don't look at me. Anyway, today's guest is an upstanding gentleman, a filmmaker and author by the name of Barry Norman. Barry and I had an epic stream of consciousness style conversation about his various roles in the entertainment business over the years as a radio show host, a record label representative, and of course, a filmmaker and an author. Barry had so many awesome experiences that led to so many great stories, we didn't even begin to crack the surface. Stories about the early days of a little known band named Nirvana, how one of his artists, some dude named David Bowie or something, may have intentionally tanked the record label he was working for, and how he came to cross paths with the creator of the Toxic Avenger himself, Lloyd Kaufman. And of course, the other crazy life experiences that became fodder for his literary masterpieces. Honestly, just too much to talk about in such a short time span. If you're a fan of listening to stories about the crazy paths that life can sometimes take you on, then stick around and listen to us go down a ton of random rabbit holes. So put on your flannel, tie up your chucks, and welcome to Misery Point Radio, filmmaker and author Barry Norman. All right. Hey, Barry, welcome to the show, man. Thank you so much for joining me today.
My pleasure, Mike. How you doing?
I'm, all things considered, with all the craziness, doing pretty well. How about yourself? How are you holding up over there on the East Coast?
Not bad. Like I said, spending copious times by myself is just something I'm kind of used to. And I take a lot of walks. And the good thing is people are still not walking where I live in Gloucester. So it's I can't really tell the difference.
Yeah. Gloucester. I love those English words that you really don't quite know how to pronounce them and you hope you're pronouncing them right, like Worcester. Is it Worcestershire? Is it Gloucestershire? But yeah,
well, you got to hit
Gloucester.
It with the Boston accent too. It's Gloucester.
Gloucester. It's Chatter. Yeah, I've got relatives over in Rhode Island, so not too far from that style of speech for sure. The R's go where they don't belong, and then you leave them out where they do belong, like Havid and Toyota.
yep. That's yeah. It.
So, but you're doing all right over there. Not, things aren't too crazy. You're surviving, getting by. So that's good.
Yeah. Well, actually, since I've taken to writing the last few years, it's actually been enhancing that because it's all I can really do.
Yeah. Well,
so
you got.
I've been fooling around writing things and working on a couple books that I wrote mostly last year, try to get them out. So yeah, it's been fine. I hate to say I'm enjoying this because that's not really true, but it's not really been a major infringement. Yeah. On what I normally do.
Awesome. Well, you brought up your writing. We're definitely going to spend some time talking about that. And as I've become familiar with kind of you and what you do. And by the way, shout out to our mutual friend, Steve Joyner, for hooking this up. Thank you, Steve. I'm really digging in and I'm finding out just how varied your career in the entertainment industry is. I mean, we're talking radio work, film work, writing, working with the WCW, you know, doing some record label stuff, just kind of all over the place. So what I'd love to do is let's just start from the beginning, man. How did you get going in the entertainment industry?
It actually started with my best friend and I hated our current jobs. I was selling direct mail advertising, and he was managing an apartment. Actually, not man. He was a super at a decent apartment complex in Brooklyn Heights. And we were both saying we hated it. What do we want to do? And we both decided we're both passionate about music. And how do you get into the music business? And I saw an ad in the back of Rolling Stone. So you want to get into the music business. So we looked that up, and it was a school called the Music Business Institute, MBI, part of the art institutes. And this was fairly new. And we checked into it, and they had these great equipment, 24-track studios. They had a half-ton truck full of all the equipment if you want to do live sound for concerts. They taught you radio promotion, everything. We checked out everything except if they actually can get you a job in the industry. So it was $12,000 for a year. We said, yeah, let's do that. So we go. I was actually living in Florida. He was living in New York. We then moved to Atlanta, where it was. We thought, well, the music business in the South is based in Atlanta. We did the year course and found out they really had no clout whatsoever. Now, it also taught television production for MTV, and I kind of gravitated towards TV. My friend Bruce still wanted to be in the music business. We were actually older than virtually everyone else in the class. I was 29. He was 37. It was rock and roll high school.
Yeah, right.
I mean, the first day where they went around the room, what do you want to know? What do you want to be? I want to be Bruce Springsteen's live sound man. All right. What do you want to be? I want to be a top engineer and producer. That really wasn't going to happen. He actually, at the end of the course, he actually did get a job for a promotion for a small record label, and he moved back to New York working for Grudge Records. And I actually got a job with CNN. I mean, the only television company in the country that would hire people with virtually no experience. I mean, the TV production I did there, it gave me enough that I knew a little bit about it, but they hired people because they knew they weren't paying you anything.
Oh, right.
And if you try to get a job anywhere else in television for one of the major networks out of New York for an affiliate, which is almost all a union, you weren't getting it. So I got the job at CNN. This is February 1988, and this is part of Turner Broadcasting. So Turner Broadcasting has all kinds of other divisions, and they would have postings on their bulletin board for any other jobs in the company. And I moved on to CNN Sports as a production assistant, which was fun, but everyone wanted to be a field producer. Now, the guy they send to the Super Bowl or to the World Series, and the two guys that had that job weren't leaving it. So you weren't going anywhere from a production system. So I walked by the bulletin board one day, and it said, for World Championship Wrestling, Public Relations Manager. I go, okay, it's a management division, so that's good, so it's going to pay more. WCW, it's live television, syndicated television, pay-per-views, merchandising, all kinds of stuff. I thought it would be creative. So I turned out to be the only person who applied for that job. So that's how I got it into WCW. And WCW, as a publicist, the guy that was the executive vice president, he came from Pizza Hut. He had no knowledge of wrestling, didn't care about wrestling. A friend of his was, his division was ahead of WCW. So we hired this guy, Jim Hurd, and he was great for me. He goes, he looked and sounded like a longshoreman. So the first day I met him, he goes, Barry, I have no idea what a publicist for wrestling does. Do whatever you want to do. So I got to get creative. As I got more and more used to the job and got a better Rolodex, I was able to cast guys in TV shows, get guys cast in movies like Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles Part 2. I got to speak to Vincent Price on the phone one day because they asked me to. We used to have Elvira. She was always the person that did our promos for our Halloween Havoc pay-per-view, and she did it like 4 years in a row. So they come to me and go, Barry, get us Vincent Price. Okay, I mean, I finally tracked down his agent, and one day I get a call on the phone. I go, is this Barry Norman? This is Vincent, I mean, the voice. And then he starts apologizing, says his health won't allow him to do it, and he's going on and on about how glad he was that I thought of him. And I'm going, oh my God, this is Vincent Price apologizing to me. So WCW was a cool gig. It got me to doing a lot of things, but the music kind of still was there. So once again, one weird looking in the back of a magazine, looking to get in the music business. I get into television. My friend gets into music. But every day we used to talk on the phone. He'd call me like at 10 o'clock, and we'd continue to talk about the music industry. And around 1990-91, he and I both noticed some strange things going on Top 40 radio, that a couple of bands that came through college radio, EMF and Jesus Jones, had the number one hit. One had it in late 1991, had it in 1991. And we started hearing that other bands and artists that you would never hear on a top 40, you know, contemporary hit radio station that in 1991 was mostly disposable dance music, like CNC Music Factory.
Yeah, I was just going to say that.
So we're seeing this trend. So I'm working in my, you know, public relations gig, and he's, you know, working for this small label, Grudge Records, but we're noticing certain trends in the music industry. We said, what if this is something that we can actually get on top of? I mean, I still always had a love for music industry, and he's in it, and we're talking about this thing. And over the next, you know, couple months, we came up with an idea. What if we create a nationally syndicated radio show for, we hated the term, but you know what it is, alternative music. So, yeah, because what does that mean? Alternative to what? But that's what it was. No, they finally dubbed it that. So we said, if we can create a format that we can put it on AOR, you know, album-oriented rock radio, which is obviously mostly classic. That was when you got Beatles, Stones, The Who, Led Zeppelin.
Sure.
And then CHR. CHR is contemporary hit radio or top 40. That was the Billboard, no top 40 hits. So more of these artists could actually get their way on those formats without completely wrecking the format, because they're not going to take them on, you know, add them, put them into light, medium, heavy airplay. So we're talking about this. And then another weird thing happened to me in wrestling. I get a call one day out of the blue from this guy named John Silva. And he says, no, he's a huge WCW fan. We have some house shows coming up in areas that he's going to be traveling to, like Knoxville, Tennessee. Can he get some comp tickets? And he said, by the way, I'm a band manager. And I didn't even think to ask him what bands he managed or anything like that. Our house shows back then, WCW wasn't no kicking ass like it did a few years later.
Right.
Our house shows never. I mean, the house shows is just the shows in the small towns where we had a syndicated radio, syndicated TV show. That was part of the contract. If we got a station to play our syndicated shows, we had to be there for the live show to cross promote. So I comped him for a whole bunch of these shows that he asked for. And then one day I get a package in the mail addressed to me at my WCW office, and it's from him. And it's Nirvana's Nevermind CD. This is before it was released.
Damn.
So I listened to this and I said, oh my God, the lid is going to blow off this thing. This thing is going to change everything. And if we're not doing something now, I said, we'll have waited too late. So I called my friend. I said, I just heard this band, Nirvana. I said, we got to find a way to get our show together. We have to make a demo. So I called John Silva and said, can you get me an interview? Can we interview Nirvana? And he said, I'll see if I can set that up. And he did. He set it up for Friday, January 10th, 1992. The night before they were going to be on Saturday Night Live. So they're definitely on the upswing. So they're definitely one of the people are starting to really hear about them. They're starting to make some noise. So we get an interview with them. My friend Bruce in New York, he actually had a friend who worked for Billboard, and he started getting some interviews with bands like Michael Hutchins of NXS. We got David Lowry of Cracker. These are some of the bands that were starting to filter in. We make the demo, and we actually get a syndicator interested in us, a syndicator called Super Radio. And so now we actually have a company that's going to, we can produce the show and distribute it. At the same time, my job at WCW got eliminated.
It got eliminated?
It got eliminated.
Or you got eliminated.
No, well, I got eliminated. Well, here's what happened there, since you brought it up. They fired Jim Hurd, the executive vice president, and the guy that hired him, who was his superior, he didn't know how to interview. I mean, Jim Hurd was his friend from Pizza Hut. So he goes around to the company in TBS, hey, who wants to be the new executive vice president of WCW? And this, fifth grade lawyer raises his hand, I'll do it. So he becomes the new executive vice president. And after 2 weeks, I finally get a meeting with him. I've been asking to meet with them. And he goes, okay, Barry, I want you to set up a press conference. We have this pay-per-view coming up in Kansas City, and I want a press conference. And I go, oh, God, I knew what he wanted. He wanted to be at the lectern with 1,000 media representatives, all with TV cameras and microphones, holding on to his every word, because it's a big deal to him.
Right.
And I said, it's not going to happen. I said, the mainstream press that covers wrestling are not going to send someone to Kansas City because they don't cover it that way. It's not that big a deal. They do some stuff like New York Daily News covered wrestling. the Miami Herald, and then there was the wrestling writers that were, you know, they were poor. No one was sending them. And he said, I'm the executive vice president of a Turner Broadcasting Division. So, you know, they'll be there. So I twisted every arm I could, and I got three people to show up in this big conference room. He had no food and drink that he figured was going to be for a couple hundred people. So a week later, that's when my position got eliminated. But the good thing is that we had this deal for no further syndicated show. I would have to move to New York anyway if I'm going to produce it with my friend. So that's how I ended up, you know, getting actually into the music industry from, I guess, a left turn from being in the Music Business Institute for a year. So I moved to New York so my friend and I can actually produce the show. Part of the deal that the syndicator said is we had to clear New York radio. And we did. We cleared WNEW, which was the oldest AOR station in the country. Now, they're the one that actually created the format of classic rock. And they gave us Monday night at 9 p.m., they kicked out their Led Zeppelin show, Get the Lead Out. And by this time, my friend Bruce was working for a new record label called Savage Records, and he got me a job there because, I mean, otherwise I was on unemployment trying to live in New York City.
Sure.
So he got me a job there as his assistant. He was the head of East Coast Promotion, so I'm his butt boy. But still, I have a job at a record label that David Bowie is signed to. And Gene Loves Jezebel, you know, so that's cool. So I'm able to meet David Bowie and Gene Loves Jezebel, and we're producing the show, and we're getting rave reviews from all the stations that we're on. I mean, my friend and I, we cleared ourselves New York, Baltimore, and Hartford, and then the syndicator is supposed to do the rest. And the way you get paid in syndication, whether it's TV or radio, you have to clear 80% of the major markets: New York, Dallas, LA, Chicago.
And just for definition's sake, what do you mean when you refer to clearing a market?
In other words, you have to get a station in one of those major markets to take your show.
Okay.
So to do that, they're obviously eliminating an hour of programming. And then the way it works is we get 60% of the national advertising and the local station will get 40%. They take syndicated shows because they think this is a show that we don't have the means to make. It's going to get higher ratings than what we can get, which means even though we're only getting 40% of the ad buys, it'll be higher. Plus, you know, the lead-in show is going to get higher ratings, the show that comes after. So you have to have a show that's good enough that all these major markets are going to want. And some of the major markets are actually going to charge you. In other words, if you want to get on New York radio, to get on WNEW, besides taking one of their DJs, one of the top DJs, Carol Miller, to be one of our co-hosts of the show, we actually had to pay them $750 a week. No, to clear that market. This is how it works. I mean, you don't have to do it for a lot of markets, but a New York and LA that says, yeah, you want an hour of our airtime. No, we're losing money. They're not. If the show does well enough, they're actually going to make more money. But they can do this. But that's how we clear New York, and I cleared Orlando station there, WXXL. So the show's going well because we're on New York radio. Any artist we want to talk to, the record label is letting us talk to. We interviewed Lou Reed the night after he performed with U2 when they performed. They did one of his songs, "Satellite of Love."
Oh yeah.
Anyone we wanted to talk to, anyone that we wanted to interview, we got the MTV 120 Minutes tour. They had PIL with Johnny Rotten, Ed Kowalczyk of Live. I mean, anyone we wanted to interview, we got. So this is part of our show, to introduce acts that either been around for a while but are now getting, they're now actually starting to filter into top 40 radio. So the show is actually, my friend and I are figuring out we're getting better at it every single week. And every single week we ask Super Radio, how many stations did you clear? Because obviously we can't get the money until we're at 80%.
Right.
So every week they go, we got you 20 more stations this week. We got 30 more this week. So we go, wow, we're kicking ass.
Yeah, right.
And we're getting written up by, like Billboard said, this new show, Cross Currents, this is really going to help promote the modern rock, the alternative music thing. R&R Radio and Records and one of the big trade. So we're doing really well. We think we're doing great. After 7 weeks of doing the show, we keep on getting a list. We never got a list of the stations that are cleared. So we finally had to get our lawyer to force them to divulge what stations have you cleared. How close are we to getting to that 80% threshold? Finally, they released a list. It has like Wenatchee, Washington; Redding, California; Milledgeville, Georgia. a bunch of nothing stations. In other words, I mean, we could be on 1,000 of those and you're not going to get national advertising. We then found out that they were actually for sale. They added our show just to increase the sale price because, hey, we got this hip alternative music show. And meanwhile, they're not working it. It's their job to know they have obviously a lot of contacts with these big stations because they have other shows.
Right.
That they have no 400, 500, 600 stations cleared for. They're not doing anything. They're not doing their diligence. Sometimes it takes a lot of work to get a station to finally, okay, I'll take your show. Here's a time slot. Then they have to negotiate that. I mean, if it's a 4 a.m. time slot, it's not going to do any good. So we, like I said, the cost of producing this show, besides the $7.50 a week that we had to pay, we had to pay the two hosts. We had Carol Miller and I wasn't happy that just Carol Miller, because she was a classic rock DJ on WNEW. So I convinced Dave Kendall, who at that time was hosting MTV's 120 Minutes, their alternative music show. So he gave us credibility. And when I pitched it to him, he said, "Yeah, I'll do this show." So we had to pay his salary, we had to pay Carol's salary, and we had the top engineer in the business. So we had some costs. I did get free studio time. I convinced a studio that only did a rap and hip hop. And they decided that, okay, well, if we had this alternative music show and at the end of the show, we would give them a shout out, that said maybe they would get some of these new acts and alternative music. So there was they gave us this little studio they weren't using, but we free studio time.
Oh, hell yeah.
Every single week. Spin Magazine gave us free ads every week because we also had to say we're compiling our research from Spin Magazine, so we had some cool elements that were pro bono, but it was still costing us. So after 12 weeks only, we had to stop the show because it was costing us a couple of $1,000 a week and we didn't have any money in. So. But it did, as I mentioned to you, two of the bands that we actually added on our show actually got broke by the show. I mentioned Live and Four Non-Blondes, mm-hmm. because since our show was on New York radio, and this is kind of what we thought the show could do, that some radio stations are hearing music that normally wouldn't be pitched or wouldn't ever add onto their playlist. WNEW did add Live and Four Non-Blondes after they heard it on our show, and it started going higher and higher as far as light airplay, medium, heavy, and then other markets, because every music director or program director, if you're the promo guy trying to pitch them a song or to play to add to their playlist, the first thing they say is, "Oh, we only care what's going on in our market." The second thing they say is, "Where else is it playing?"
Right.
And if you say you have New York, that's a big deal. So, Live and Four Non-Blondes actually, charted and did pretty well because we put them on one of our weekly shows that WNEW did.
Yeah.
So that was the foray. It didn't last long. It was only 3 months, but it was the first time people technically outside of the music business. My friend worked for a label, but that didn't really count. All syndicated shows are either a syndicator like Super Radio finds a local act, like a Howard Stern was a local radio DJ, and then a syndicator says, "Wow, we think this guy's good, we're going to syndicate him." Or the syndication companies develop their own show. We heard that all the big syndicators were developing an alternative music show, and then when they heard, that's at least what they told us when we were pitching all the syndicators to take us, and we knew we had to strike quickly. So we actually got the deal, and then the deal turned out to be the bad one because they screwed us. it was the right time. It was obviously the right time for it. We think the format, we think our show is pretty good. I mean, we did once again, we were very, very creative. We had some programmers calling us the day after the show aired in their market, saying how great some of the segments were. Are you familiar with Bob Vila? Remember when he had that TV show?
Home Improvement stuff, yeah.
So I came up with an idea. We were going to have this one set where the first song was going to be Madness, Our House, even though that was an 80s song, but it kind of set the tone of what the segment was going to be. The next song was from a band that I really liked that was just starting to break a little bit called The Kitchens of Distinction. And then we were going to end the set with a song from In Spiral Carpets. So we had Our House, Kitchens of Distinction, In Spiral Carpets. I said, what if we can get Bob Vila to do the front and back announce for that segment? So once again, from my WCW Rolodex, I was able, I had all kinds of managers and things like that. And I tracked down his manager. I had his number. I called him up and he puts Bob Vila on the phone. And he goes, And I told him what kind of show it was. He goes, so my kids will think I'm cool if I do this. And I go, yeah, of course they will. So we did it for nothing. I mean, I sent him the script, you know, and he did the front announce for this one segment. You know, we come out of the break and he goes, hi, this is Bob Biela. Welcome to this old Cross Currents. Yeah, that's what I'm doing. And he announced, you know, those three songs front and back announced, and it was hilarious. So little things like that we try to do. In other words, Kissing Distinction and Inspiral Conference weren't getting a lot of airplay. So how do you present that material to people where they're not going to, you know, shut your show up, make it kind of fun and different? So that's some of the stuff that we did, you know, that was that made the show what should have been a big success, you know, only last 3 months.
Yeah, well, you were kind of a victim of circumstance, sadly.
Yeah, like I said, I mean, unfortunately, we both failed. We got really good at this show. I mean, we think we're picking, you know, artists that a lot of people haven't heard before. I mean, some artists still, I mean, unfortunately, they didn't break. You can't predict everything. But we think every song and every artist we pick at least should have been. And it still made the shows interesting. Like I said, we got great interviews with, I mean, like I mentioned Dave Lowry with Cracker. We got him. He was in a phone booth, you know, in Bakersfield, California. And somehow we got crosstalk with Trucker CV, you know, CVs. Which actually made it more interesting,
right?
when you're hearing him talk with all that in the background.
It's kind of like Spinal Tap.
Yeah. So, I mean, so it was the right idea at the right time, just the syndicator that picked us up. And we were so excited. I mean, we originally were courted by the first radio syndicator in the business, a company called DIR, which stood for Dig It Radio. They did the one of the first syndicated radio show called the King Biscuit Flower Hour, which was live concerts. You know, King Biscuit was actually a flower company, so they were the sponsor. And the guy that headed up DIR was a guy called Bob Meyerowitz. And he was sued by every band because he basically taped them illegally, put them in this show that made huge amounts of money. And he was the first one, you know, that we approached and says, yeah, I'll take your show. And then I fly up from Atlanta. I hadn't moved yet to sign the contract with him. And he says, oh, by the way, I'll own the show. And I realized if he owns it, we're employees, which means we can be fired at any moment. I said, I can't do that. He goes, well, I don't need you. I can call the show Electric Currents instead of Cross Currents. So we realized we were going to be screwed then. And that's when we, you know, kept on pitching. And then Super Radio picked us up. Bob Meyerowitz went on to start UFC.
Yeah.
So he made $1 zillion doing that. He's just one of those lowlifes that just keeps on falling up. I mean, he had this huge radio show that he screwed. I mean, every band in the world ended up suing him.
Right.
I don't think any of them collected, but he was the first one that was interested in Cross Currents. So that was the foray into the music industry that should have, coulda, woulda. We did get to interview some great artists. Like I said, I got to talk to, you know, Nirvana, which was really, really interesting because Kurt Cobain is a fascinating character. I could tell even then he could tell the trajectory of the band, and he was already miserable.
Yeah.
He was already communicating that he thought of himself as a hypocrite because all the people that are loving Nirvana were the people that used to beat him up in school.
Exactly.
And he wasn't happy with that. And he said this is their first big major label album. And he says he figured out there's already a formula on us. You know, we start slow, then start kicking ass, then go back to slow again. So he goes, we're probably not gonna be able to stray from that. So he felt constrained. So I asked him, I said, why'd you do it? Why'd you sign the major label? You could have stayed on Sub Pop and been a regional band, probably not have to have second jobs, but you're never going to, you know, play the stadiums. You're never going to play 20, 30, 40, 50,000. You're not going to be on MTV, and you're not going to make a lot of money. I said, you obviously knew this could happen if you signed the major label contract. So why did you? And he didn't really have an answer for that because he was smart enough to know this is what could happen. So on the one hand, I don't feel too bad for him because he's extremely bright. And he knew that was probably, I think he knew this was going to be the thing. And I don't know, we didn't get into it because Kristen Novoselic and Dave Grohl were there. Maybe he felt the pressure that, well, these guys are loving this. And how can I turn away from that?
Sure.
Just because it's not what I wanted. So he was really interesting to talk to, very, very introspective, but it was hard to hear how miserable he already was because he knew where things were going.
Yeah. That's a, it's just crazy how things work out that way. I kind of want to backtrack for a minute, though. And you brought up Savage Records and you brought up David Bowie. And I wanted to kind of dive down that rabbit hole for a minute. So because you told me off the air when we were first chatting that there's a really interesting story about what happened with Savage Records because of David Bowie.
Right. Savage Records was run by these two young kids from Jordan whose parents were like oil sheikhs with no gazillion dollars. And they always wanted, I guess, run a record company. So their dad gave them $7 million, started a record company. So we had nice offices, right near Carnegie Hall and the Russian Tea Room. And the main, the first thrust of it was signing new artists. So we actually had a lot of good new artists. But if you're a new record label, once again, even though payola technically doesn't exist, it still does. The way a lot of new artists get broken is the major label has these huge stars, and then they go to the radio stations. Hey, remember we had that Tom Petty concert in England, and we flew two of your listeners in that contest to England, put them up in a 5-star hotel, took them backstage to meet Tom Petty. Remember that? We want you to put this guy on in heavy rotation. So that's how you break new artists. So Savage Records had no artists like that, and they're not going to be able to create one of their new ones. So they said, we better sign some established artists. So they signed David Bowie. David Bowie hadn't had a hit since 1982, Let's Dance. He had been fooling around with Tin Machine for years. Tin Machine was very, very avant-garde. I actually went to see Tin Machine before I worked for Savage Records, and that was with Soupy Sales Sons, Hunt Sales, and Tony Sales. And I remember once David Bowie is singing, and all of a sudden he starts being David Bowie. He catches himself and stops because it wasn't David Bowie band. He's just a singer. He doesn't want Tin Machine to be David Bowie.
Right.
So he hadn't really had a hit. And I think, once again, kind of like Kurt Cobain, he kind of liked it that way. So he just got married to his supermodel wife, Iman, before signing this label. And these kids from Jordan didn't know anything. But the guy that was head of promotion, he came from a small label. He didn't know what he should have known. So David Bowie basically dictated everything. He says, okay. He says, I'm not going to tour. I'm not going to do interviews. I'm not going to do anything like that. I'm going to pick the first single, off the album that I record. I said, yeah, I do want an MTV video. It's going to cost you $2 million to do. And that's that. I'm on my honeymoon. And Savage Records said, okay. So they put together the album, which was called Black Tie, White Noise. And the first song David Bowie chose, he says, this will be the first relief, was a song called Jump, They Say, about suicide. Not the best song to release when your last biggest hits were all the music from Let's Dance.
Right.
It actually was a good song, and the video was brilliant, but this is not what you want to do to reintroduce David Bowie to a large audience. And then that's when the record made the next biggest mistake. They decided, and my friend and I pleaded with the head of promotion not to do this. He wanted it to release to AOR radio first. In other words, David Bowie is a classic artist. Let's release it to the classic stations first. Now, classic radio doesn't break artists. No, you have to go. I mean, we argued, let's put him on college radio. Because they don't care who you are. If they like it, they can play because they're non-commercial. That's where all the alternative artists were. That's where The Cure and other bands like that, Red Hot Chili Peppers, that were just now making mainstream hits. That's where they made their living. They made their living on college radio, played those type of towns, played those type of venues. So if you bring the college radio and it goes up the college radio chart, now you have success. You can go to top 40 radio. Hey, it's burning up college radio charts. If you fail, if what your move fails, you don't get a second chance. It doesn't matter that it's David Bowie. So they tried to go to AOR radio. AOR radio wasn't interested. So now you lost. In other words, we didn't get hardly anywhere with it. You have no place else to go. You can't now go to top 40. That's where the money is. To get him a top 40 hit, go to number one, because you have a failure. If you couldn't make David Bowie work in AOR, why am I going to add that to my playlist? So with all the money that Savage Records spent on Black Tie, White Noise, and doing everything that Bowie did, and once again, he's not doing tour, he's not doing publicity, he's not going to radio, he's not doing anything, and then the label makes the big mistake of putting him out in the wrong format. And so the whole thing dies. The whole thing just killed. And that's what ended Savage Records, because they just didn't have enough that their parents cut them off and said, here's your startup money. Good luck.
Yeah.
And no, we like I said, we had a lot of good young artists that, and they thought that David Bowie and the other artists that had some establishment was Gene Loves Jezebel. I mean, they had you know, a minor hit on College Radio years ago in Jealous.
Yeah.
Now, one other funny thing that happened at Savage Records is I accidentally got Mariah Carey a hit. We had this Australian heavy metal band called Saints and Sinners, you know, who were really, really bad. But their lead singer actually had, you know, that good titanium-throated, you know, no heavy metal voice, and he had a look that I thought 14-year-old girls are going to love. He actually looked like, you know, a Native American. He had the long black hair, the tiny butt, the ones that the 14-year-old girls like. And I said, why don't we remake, you know, the Harry Nilsson song, you know, Without You, have him scream the chorus, just writhe and scream, make a video of him doing that, just writhing on the ground, screaming, I can't live. And I said, and then we can release that, you know, to Top 40, and the young girls are going to eat it up. And of course, young boys, since he's still, you know, kind of a metal type singer, and the young girls like him. And the label said no. Now, one of the guys who was a consultant for the label was Frank DeLeo. He used to be Michael Jackson's manager. He also played Mr. Big in the Wayne's World movie, so he had a lot of clout in the industry, and he was good friends with Tommy Mottola, who was the president of Sony Records, who was married to Mariah Carey.
Yeah.
Right. So he takes the idea to Tommy. He says, "Hey, what if we do a remake, you know, of Nielsen's Without You? That sounds good." Mariah Carey records it, and 2 years later, it's number one. So I can't prove that it was because I, you know, because Frank DeLeo was in the room when I was at a meeting where I was saying, why don't we do Saints and Sinners lead singer, Noah, Without You. I'd like to think that I kind of, that's where we got the idea from. You know, you can't say it's stolen because it's just an idea. I can't copyright it. But I kind of feel pretty sure that's how Mariah Carey ended up recording that song, because Frank DeLeo went to his buddy, who goes to his wife, and there you go.
We're going to go with that version.
Yeah, that. Well, have you heard it?
No.
Well, I mean, look, Mariah Carey can sing. It's not my style. I mean, she definitely has a vocal range. It's definitely. I mean, that's not who I would have thought of to record. I thought a guy like this lead singer for Saints and Sinners who had the look and actually did have the pipes. It's just that the band was crappy.
Sure.
I mean, it's not the first good singer for a crappy band that, you know, someone said, let's take them single and forget these guys. So, but I was way, you know, led down the totem pole. I'm the assistant, you know, to the, you know, the East Coast promotion guy, and everyone knows that we're friends, that we were trying to do this, you know, the syndicated radio show. So I wasn't listened to, and then that's what happened. So that was my foray, you know, my deep dive into the music industry, working at Savage Records, meeting David Bowie, giving an idea to Mariah Carey, meeting Frank DeLeo, and then watching the whole thing crumble.
Well, hey. You know, you got to be known for something.
Well, I mean, if you're going to fail, fail big.
Fail,
I mean,
big,
we,
man.
We did interview some great artists. We had a lot of fun, you know, on the show. I mean, when I mentioned the David Lowery interview, and of course, Crackers, their first big hit was, you know, What the World Needs Now. And one of the lines, you know, from that song is another Frank Sinatra. So my friend and I came up with an idea of this. We're playing, the first thing for that set was we played David Lowery's first band, Camper Van Beethoven, and they did a remake of the 60s song, Pictures of Matchstick Men. So this is our way sometimes of saying, these artists didn't just fall off the turnip truck. Some of them have been around, you just might not have heard them because they were smaller and more obscure. So we play Pictures of Matchstick Men. We then we start playing parts of the interview, and we go into What the World Needs Now, and he mentioned about that thing about the lyric about Frank Sinatra, and he thought that Frank Sinatra was, and his words were, a benign dictator. So we segue out of What the World Needs Now to you hear actual Frank Sinatra about to sing My Way, and then we segue into that into, you know, Sid Vicious of the Sex Pistols doing his version of Regrets.
Nice.
And that was that segment. So that's the kind of, you know, things that we would think of that people go, wow, this is, you know, this is really interesting. But that was, it was just 3 months. It sounds a lot longer when I talk about it, but no, 3 months. That was fascinating. I mean, I was living in an apartment in Queens over a fish market with no air conditioning, and so
Nice.
I mean, I mean that was my New York life then.
Yeah. Well, ultimately, you ended up in the film industry. So you kind of bounced from radio to record, well, from wrestling to radio to record, and then you ended up somehow saying, "Fuck it, I'm going to be a filmmaker."
Well, after that ended, I said, "What now?" And I said, "I think I'm going to try film."
Yeah.
So I actually moved back to Atlanta because I left my dog there. I mean, I thought the show was going to be big, and I was going to actually be able to get a house in suburban New Jersey with a fence yard. So I moved back to Atlanta, no, be with my dog. I actually go back to working with WCW, the worst job ever. I mean, my job then was to actually do dubbings of the three syndicated shows. So that was working all night Friday, all night Saturday, putting hundreds and hundreds, just loading up, here's the master tape, putting it up, putting all the tapes that it's going to dub onto, labeling it, and I'd be up all night Friday, all night Saturday, and sometimes part of Sunday, doing it. But I said, I'm going to be a filmmaker. How do you be a filmmaker? So I go to the library and I look. There's not that many books about filmmaking, but I found one called Feature Filmmaking at Used Car Prices by a guy named Rick Schmidt.
I've read this book.
You've read the book.
I do. I
Okay.
own it.
It's, well, I read the book. I said, this is fascinating. But since I'm not as, as you found out, as we were trying to figure out how I can do Skype with you, I'm not the most technical guy in the world. I said, I think I can understand writing and directing. I'm never going to be good at the technical thing about it as far as setting up shots and lighting. I says, what do I do now? So I tracked down Rick Schmidt, who was living in Port Townsend, Washington,
Right
and I
by
call
where
him
I'm
up.
at.
Where, yeah, so I actually call him up and he says, well, it's funny you should call. I was actually thinking of doing something, taking my book and making like a seminar. A feature filmmaking at used car prices seminar where people like you who've never directed nor produced a film before, you and a whole bunch of other newbies can get together and you'll each put in a little bit of money. It'll cost you each a lot less than it would to do your own film. So I decide I'll do that. So he's about to make a film with me and four other filmmakers who we've never met. So I work all night Friday, all night Saturday. Leave no Sunday, take three flights, rent a car from Seattle, drive a couple hours to Port Townsend, which is, as you know, is about an hour or two from Seattle.
Yep.
So I haven't slept in like 24 hours, and we're on set at 10 a.m. Now we all meet at this restaurant for breakfast, and we're on set. Now Rick Schmidt has never done scripts; everything is improv. Before all of us, all five of us, no supposed no writer, producer, directors came up with some ideas, and all he did. He secured a really top-notch cinematographer, some locations, and some non-actors to be in it. We just start shooting, and it's you just start figuring out what the film is going to be as you're shooting it. So we shot for 5 days, did some rudimentary editing for 5 days. This was on 16 millimeter, so no editing on 16 millimeter. I found out 1 day is totally to sync up the sound with film. The whole idea of the clapboard.
The whole
That's an
clapboard, yep.
entire day, to do that. So after 10 days, everyone got a rough cut, of what this film was going to be. The other four directors thanked Rick. Yeah, great experience. And I talked to Rick and said, we have a film here. There's something really here, but we need to do some more editing. So he took all the footage and dubbed it down, to VHS, because now I'm a tape dubber at WCW. I have access to all this equipment. So Rick and I talking on the phone, long distance, me in Atlanta and him in Port Townsend, Washington, kept on talking about how the scenes, because there's no real linear part to this film, especially with one device that Rick has always done, which is to incorporate what he calls real life stories. So it could be cast, it could be crew, it could be a stranger we meet. We just say, put them on camera for closes. Tell a 5 minute real life story about yourself. It could be happy, could be sad, could be funny, could be quirky, whatever. So you. Those have to figure out some way to incorporate them in the film so it actually makes sense in the narrative. And this is where Rick is a genius. He's a genius editor. So we're going back and forth, and every time one of us or both of us have an idea, I cut that film onto VHS and send it to him so he can look at it and I can look at it. Finally, he has this aha moment, the one sticking point in the film. He figures out it works. Now, we go to the lab to actually make an answer print, start making copies of that, and send it to film festivals. it starts getting to film festivals all over the place. I mean, and some of the good ones will actually fly you there. Like, we got to fly to Portugal for this really prestigious film festival called Figueira da Foz, which is north of Lisbon and just south of Oporto, a really cool seaside village. And we got into Slam Dance, which was only its second year, and it's just starting to gain notoriety. We were in the Pacific Northwest Film Festival. So my first film is getting in all these film festivals. It also got into IFFM, the Independent Feature Film Market at New York City, which played at the Angelica, you know, one of the classic art house theaters in the country. They take films as work in progresses there too. So we first submitted it as a work in progress. I think I mentioned this to you. While we're there, only Rick and I went. The other four directors, you know, producers, they loved the experience, and that was it. But you know, Rick and I have been working on this film for a year. So he and I are attending these festivals. We attend IFFM there, and Kevin Smith is there for his first film, Clerks. Mm-hmm. And so you have a screening, and all the people who are in the industry, whether they're from a film festival, they will have badges so you can identify who they are. All the filmmakers have badges. And every time people go into a screening, there's a person with IFFM there with a clipboard to find out who is there, who was represented, because not everyone will stay for the entire film. They'll leave for whatever. They didn't like it, or they have another film that starts. So our film, Blues for the Avatar, we look afterwards, and we had a who's who of reps. And a couple of them, actually, if they really like your film, they'll wait to talk to you. So one of the reps from the Berlin Film Festival, one of the most prestigious film festivals in Europe. I mean, that's like Sundance is here. That can make you get distributors who want to pick up your film.
Sure.
Because Europe is a lot more, they like a lot more of the art house films than we did here back in 1994, 1995. But so we met a couple of the reps, and then we're looking down the list. There's reps from Sundance, from Florence, from Vienna, from the Museum of Modern Art, New Directors, New Film Series. So we're getting this who's who, and then Kevin Smith only had one rep there, and that was from Sundance. He gets into Sundance. We ended up not getting into any of those really prestigious film festivals that had reps there. He gets into Sundance, wins the audience award, you know, gets a deal with Miramax, and Kevin Smith is made.
Right.
We got into a lot of really, really, you know, cool festivals, none that have the industry there. I mean, at that time, Slam Dance was cool because it's at the same time as Sundance. So people, you know, the whole idea of that was everyone in the industry is in Park City, Utah. So if they're there for a Sundance, they may come to our festival.
Sure.
And now if you go to Park City, Utah in January, you know, as soon as we don't have a quarantine, every single person in the entertainment industry is there. I mean, actors, directors, and distributors, other film festivals. People have no business being there because they don't have a film. But, I mean, the cast of Saturday Night Live would always be there because you have to be there.
Right.
So the funny thing is you'll have someone driving up and down Main Street of Park City with a van saying, hey, I got a film in here. I want to see it. You know, there'll be people projecting their films on the side of the building because all they need is that one person to, that's interesting. I want to talk to you about it.
Yeah.
So it was really fun to be at Slam Dance, and we came in second for best narrative feature, and the film that won was a film called The Day Trippers, and the guy that directed that, I forget his name, he also directed Superbad.
Okay.
Later, I mean, so he became a big deal. So his first film, you know, won. It was actually produced by Steven Soderbergh. So we had real actors in it. He had Hope Davis and Stanley Tucci and Liev Schreiber, and we had no-name actors from the port towns in Washington area. But so that was how, you know, one door, no shut, no close on me, and I decided, okay, what do I do? I'll be a filmmaker.
And at some point down the road then, you made a couple of films, and you ended up encountering Lloyd Kaufman, famous, of course, for the Troma studios and amazing movies like The Toxic Avenger and Surf Nazis Must Die and stuff like that. So how did you encounter Lloyd, and what effect did that have on you?
Well, what happened was I stopped doing the tape dubbing job because weekends are a key time if you're going to try to make films, and other people, if they have 9-to-5 jobs. So I ran out of money, and then I took the worst job I ever had, which is as a bill collector. A friend of mine on my I play street hockey, and we had a party afterwards, and then this one friend, just looks like a typical hockey player. You could tell he wasn't that bright, but he has the party at his house. He lives in a freaking mansion. And his next door neighbor is Vince, I forget his last name, Vince Johnson, who was at that time the star linebacker for my team, the New England Patriots, is living next to him because they have these gorgeous houses in Alpharetta, Georgia, which is one of the nicest suburbs of Atlanta. So I go, son of a bitch, how do you afford this? And he goes, you need a job, don't you? So he was a manager at a bill collection company. And so I got hired on as that, and I did it for 1 month, and I literally got physically ill during that job. It was the absolute most nightmare job I've ever had, and I lasted 1 month. I hated everything about it, but I made a film about it. I decided this is too good a thing not to make a film out of it. It's the only film I've actually ever scripted, because all the other films have been Rick Schmidt's improv. So I wrote a film that was actually a full-length feature, but I knew I wouldn't have enough money or time to do that. So I actually wrote it as a 30-minute short. And then some luck, my dad had an insurance policy. He didn't need any more liquidated, and said, okay, Barry, I'm going to give you this money, $13,000. I have money to make the film. So the first person I approached was Mick Foley, who I knew from wrestling, and he was just about to leave to go to the WWF. WCW never used him right. He wasn't a big star there. He was a big star in Japan, but not in the States. But he's about to go to WWF, where he would become a big star there. But I had him for 3 days before he went there. I hire a local production company. So I had everyone. I had gaffers. I had script supervisors. I had a half-ton truck of all the toys, dollies, everything, because I had money. I had craft services. I had catering. I had Mick Foley, and then for my co-star, my lead actress, I hired a local girl who I had met. I had taken a cinematography class in Atlanta, and the girl that was for the scene we shot was this girl named Melissa McBride.
Who now we know as, of course, Carol from The Walking Dead.
This is in the mid-90s, right? So I make this professionally done film. It looks good because I have actually real people, real cameras, real lights, real pros, doing all that. So I make this 30-minute film about my horrible experience as a bill collector. Mick played a guy who was actually based on a guy I met there. He was in jail for 14 years for manslaughter. Got out, got a job as a bill collector, and loved it because he says, I'm more of a criminal now than I ever was. But this is actually legal. I said, I am just destroying people left and right, every single day, making a crap load of money and getting an attaboy.
Yeah.
So he was based on my lead character, but I didn't want to make him totally horrible. So I thought Mick could play this guy where, yeah, he's kind of a scumbag, but you're going to kind of like it. Because I figured you can't totally dislike your main character. So I shoot this film in 3 days. The production company also had editing facilities. So they edit, and I get my 30-minute short film. And I, once again, I'm entering in film festivals. And one of the film festivals that I entered in, because they didn't have a fee, was Troma Dance. So I entered into Troma Dance, and once again, I'm out to the Park City, because Troma Dance is there the same time as Sundance and Slam Dance and Slam Dunk and Moon Dance and No Dance and Pull Down Your Pants Dance. So there's Troma Dance. So out of this Troma Dance, they create a compilation DVD called The Best of Troma Dance Volume 1. And they use Deadbeats on the cover because even though some of the other films had some known people like Klaus Kinski, who was a big time actor from years ago, but no one would have known today. So Mick was obviously started at WWF, and he's starting to become a big deal. So that's what attracted Troma to this film, because they said, you mentioned some of the films, Toxic Avenger, Surf Nazis Must Die. They figured their audience and the wrestling audience is a good Venn diagram.
Yeah,
it's the same people, so that's why they accepted us into Troma Dance, and that's why they put it on the cover of The Best of Troma Dance Volume 1, and the thing sold tens of thousands of units. Now, because it was a short film, and because it's Lloyd Kaufman, I really like Lloyd Kaufman. He's extremely honest. He says, Barry, you're not going to make any money from this. He says, this is going to be a 10% net deal. That means that you're going to get 10% net after I deduct all my expenses. And guess what? I'm going to have a shitload of expenses. So no matter how many units it sells, you're not going to make anything. And he did not lie. I got a check for $2.43. You know, after 1 year of it being on the market, they wrote my name wrong on the check. They put it Norman with a D.
Nice.
So of course, I didn't cash it. You know, I immediately laminated it. So this is the indie filmmakers. This is what we live for.
Yeah.
And then a few years ago, I called Lloyd Kaufman up again and says, "Hey, guess what? My second co-star." In Deadbeats is now a bigger star than the first. And then I said, it's Melissa McBride. I said, oh, shit. So then they release it on video on demand. Once again, it made a crap load of money, and I haven't seen a nickel of that.
You didn't even get $2.43?
I didn't even get if you remember the John Cusack movie, Better Off Dead, where the paper boy is chasing, I want my $2! Well, that's been me ever since.
Nice.
But I can't get mad because it's a thing on the internet now. Every now and again, when I'm feeling worthless, I will Google Deadbeats Melissa McBride. I find Facebook pages and other sites dedicated to it where they've actually done screenshots, transcribed the dialogue on it. It's been pirated all over the world. It's been seen everywhere. It's been reviewed everywhere. The reviews have never been good. I actually get kind of trashed in the film.
Yeah.
Now I will say this. Just like I think I got a hit from Mariah Carey, I think I also helped get a scene in the film Out of Sight. That was the George Clooney, Jennifer Lopez movie that was based on an Elmore Leonard book.
Okay.
The first scene of Deadbeats, which I think was my most clever scene, is I had Mick Foley in the bushes in his car with binoculars looking at a fast food restaurant. And then he sees this big, black, muscular guy walk into the restaurant. So he goes around to the drive-thru, and he talks to the drive-thru guy. Says, see that big black guy in your restaurant? He goes, yeah, well, that's my partner. He's going to kill you unless you give me all the money. Oh, yeah, and I throw in a couple of Polish dogs, too. So that's the opening of Deadbeats. He gets caught by the police. I know we put the bubblegum machine on the back of the car, so it looks like it's behind it. So that's, the next scene is he's talking to his probation officer who says, hey, maybe you ought to get a job as a bill collector. Man, there's millions of those jobs. So that's the start of the movie. In Out of Sight, I read the Elmore Leonard book, and the movie is exactly like the book, scene for scene, except there's one scene where George Clooney goes into a bank, goes to a teller, says, see your bank president sitting at that table there? He goes, yeah. He goes, well, the guy next to him is my partner, and he's going to shoot him unless you give me all your money. So I then found out when I went to, I went to IMDb to check all the production credits to see if there's any crew from my film, because all the people I said had worked in my film were professionals. So they were the people that anytime there's something TV or film shooting in Atlanta, they could get called because they were, they had the reputation. There was some crossover. So I don't know. I don't know if they saw Deadbeats or saw one of the people that works as a crew of mine says, hey, we have an idea. You're looking for a scene. I mean, usually production people don't have that type of, hey, I have an idea. It does seem suspicious that my film was came out first. And the one scene in that movie that was not in the book, that was similar. So if nothing else, I once again, just like getting a number one hit song from Mariah Carey, I go, okay, I'm a good enough writer that I can at least write one scene in a big Hollywood film.
Awesome. Well, and then after all of that, you decide, I haven't done enough. I need to write some books.
Well, I went and got a master's degree in film studies because I decided I skipped over one step. I actually created a film festival in Georgia. First in Dahlonega, Georgia, and then I moved it to Rome, Georgia when the some neo-Nazis and the National Alliance started threatening my life. That wasn't the only reason I moved it, but I moved it to Rome, Georgia, and it became one of the most successful film festivals in the Southeast. Now, it takes, even though it's only 4 days a year, it's a year-round gig, and often I'm working 40, 50 hours a week doing that while I'm trying to do my regular job, which at that time was working for Cartoon Network. So I decided I need to be paid as an executive director because I know I founded it, I ran it, it's doing really well, and I knew that Rome, Georgia didn't have the money to pay my position. And since almost all film festivals are nonprofit, they only hire people with master's degrees. So I go back to school at Boston University, get my master's degree in film studies, and that ends in 2009 when the economy crashes. So a lot of film festivals are hurting. I got three interviews with film festivals to be an executive director. All three ended up hiring someone local who came from another nonprofit, had no film festival or filmmaker, film anything with indie filmmaking, but they thought that they would bring their sponsors with them, which is not a thing. There's no sponsors spending all this money on this nonprofit, but I like you so much, wherever you go, the money will go. So when that didn't pan out, I said, I want to stay in indie film. What can I do? And I decided to buy a movie theater. So I'm looking, once again, there's websites for everything. You want to buy a movie theater, there's an app for that. So I'm looking at theaters all over the country, and I find one in Brunswick, Maine, which is not that far from Boston. All the other ones were everywhere. I mean, Oregon, Ohio. So that one, it was also profitable, which a lot of the other ones weren't. So I buy this little art house single screen movie theater. And while I'm running that, that's when the idea comes to me is, and actually, it really wasn't, I don't really know how it started. I mean, just like the way Rich Mitt and I, know mostly him, because he'd been doing it before me, we started making films with the whole improv. I started one day, just started writing. You know, I'm at my theater like 6 o'clock in the morning, because I do a lot of my best work when it's quiet and there's nothing there. And that's when I can look at all the other films that are out there and what I can possibly get and how my schedule's looking. And I just started typing one day. And once again, a stream of consciousness started coming as far as basically my life story up to now. It was just before my 59th birthday. I'm going to be 63 this year. And I'm thinking, okay, I own this theater, which is great. The only family I have left, I lost my sister and father within 6 months of each other, 2 years prior. And that was all, my only family is my dog, who's now, he's at that point, he was 15, 15 and a half. He was diabetic and blind. And I knew what was going on there. And I said, okay, I'm not married. I have no kids. I have no family. What the hell? I mean, the Talking Heads line, how do I get here? So that was the origin of my first book, Flipping Point. And here I am. I love running a movie theater, but there's so many other parts of my life that are kind of weird. And then things like some of the things we talked about, working in the music business, becoming a filmmaker, and then things from my childhood start coming up. So I just started writing this thing, and it starts jumping all over the timeline. In other words, I didn't prep out how I'm going to write it. I didn't know chapters, parts of my life. Whatever my brain thought of at that the time I'm writing, that's the story I came out. So it'll go up and down in the timeline. And then when it was all done, I had this book that I decided I originally wanted to call it Tipping Point, but that name was taken. So I said, well, Flipping Point works too, because that's what I felt I was reaching this point. I mean, even though I've done almost everything I ever imagined I ever wanted to do. I mean, I it's not like when I was a kid, I said, I want to be in the music business. I want to work in television. I mean, besides working for CNN and WCW and Cartoon Network, I worked for 6 Olympic Games. And, one of my dreams was always to be in the Olympics. Failing that, I got to work for 6 of them, 4 of them overseas. And that was an incredible experience. So I've had these incredible experiences in my work life. My personal life has been kind of sketchy. So those things started kind of, well, look, when you're my age and you're not married and you don't have kids, you kind of wonder, what the hell? What did I do wrong? Where is this going? Why? How did I get here? So that's where Flipping Point came out. And I just started writing until one day I just said, that's it. I've written everything I want to write, because the end catches up where the beginning was. Here I am. Do I have any answers? No. And then people, after the book came out, the one question people always ask when they read it is, wow, that must have been really, really cathartic for you to write. And the answer to that is no, because it's forcing me to relive any trauma, any horrible. I mean, yes, the good stuff is there too. I mean, obviously, it was great. Even though the syndicated radio show ended and Savage Records ended, and my gig at WCW ended, even though all these things ended, they were opportunities that came, I took a shot at them. Some worked out great, some didn't. Even the ones that didn't work out, I was so grateful for the opportunity, but there's other parts of my life like, what the hell?
Right.
So that became Flipping Point.
Yeah.
And it was just interesting to get it out there, though the local bookstore in Brunswick, Maine carried it. So a lot of my customers, I promoted through my theater, so a lot of people bought the book there. It sold other places. I promoted on my Facebook thing for where I went to high school. So a lot of high school people I went to high school wanted to see if they were in it. Some of them are, and they're not happy about it. I did not write it to settle scores.
Right.
I wasn't trashing people, but yeah, when shit happened in my life, I talked about it. And it wasn't like you did this horrible thing to me. It's like these horrible things happen. And it was always trying to figure out what was my involvement in it. What did I do? Could I have done anything different? Why did this happen? I mean, I think it's like what everyone tried. When you reach a certain age and you realize you're closer to the ending than the beginning, you do want to kind of figure out where did things screw up? I mean, like I said, I'm really happy about a lot of how my life has gone. Like I said, I can die tomorrow saying I did a lot of things I never thought I would have done.
Yeah.
I love obviously the arts. I like the creativity. I always wanted to work. When I was a kid, I had no idea how to. I mean, I love going to films. Television was always a big deal growing up in the '60s. I wanted to work for those things. I didn't know how to do it, so I ended up doing other things like selling advertising, which was very, very lucrative, but I freaking hated it.
Yeah.
So flipping point was was just me writing, trying to get things out, trying to figure out why, okay, this good stuff happened, this bad stuff happened, how does it all blend together? And just from there, I just started writing books after that. I wrote a book a couple of years after that that just concentrated on my childhood, which I think ends when you end high school.
Okay.
So that book I named The Angriest Childhood in the World. let's just not screw around, because I did have a miserable, miserable childhood.
Oh, shitty, dude.
So that, well, look, I mean, Nietzsche, that which does not destroy me makes me write a book about it.
Yeah, there you go.
So that's what that book. So that book is linear, because obviously, if you're, it doesn't make sense to jump around to age 4 to 12 when your life is up to 59, you can do it. I mean, I wrote about my two marriages go back and forth in the book. So if you're reading it and flipping point, it's not going to be linear, but I think it actually makes more sense. Writing about your childhood, it does make sense. And I've written just in this past year, I've written two more books and one play.
What?
I've never written a play before. I was watching Viceland, and they have a show called The Dark Side about the dark side of wrestling. So having worked in pro wrestling, even though I mean, people think I must be the biggest fan of wrestling, I'm not. I do think it's fascinating. And obviously I worked in there, so I have a lot of insider knowledge. And it was about one of the most famous incidents called the Montreal Screwjob. Now, people who aren't familiar with that, that was Bret the Hitman Hart was one of Vince McMahon's WWF's biggest stars. He'd been there for 13 years. The year before, Vince signed him to this huge, huge contract, which he doesn't do. I mean, the WWE is like football. He will sign into a big contract, but he can terminate it.
Right.
And you're mostly getting paid on percentages. In other words, if you're one of the top stars and you're the headliner for WrestleMania, you're going to get a bigger percentage than a lower star. Same with TV, same with syndication, same with pay-per-view. It also means that nobody takes a day off because they're injured.
Yeah.
Because if you're injured and you're not going to be on the card, you're not going to make money. So that's why people in WWE just get horribly injured, because they never take a day off, because it's in their best interest not to. So Bret Hart, he signed this huge contract, and then things aren't going very well for Vince in the WWF, and he wants to, he decides that he signed this huge contract with Bret too premature. Bret's star is on the wane. He can't, it's going to break his company, so he wants Bret to leave. So Bret says, okay, and WCW starts courting him, and they are going to sign him to a big contract. So now they have to end his run at the WWF. And Bret was very, very, his character was something that he felt he developed over the years. And Vince wanted him to lose the belt in Canada, which Bret is from. And he goes, no way, I'm not going to lose in my home country. He says, that's going to hurt my character going into WCW. You can't do that. This is the way I want to do it. I will drop the belt eventually. We'll do it this way. And Vince said, okay, we'll do it that way. So they have the match in Calgary. And everything is going to script. And then all of a sudden, Shawn Michaels, who was the opponent, he gets Bret in a pinning position, and Bret thinks he's going to kick out of it. The referee, 1, 2, 3, that's it, you lose.
Oh, I fucked him.
So Bret is absolutely livid. And there's cameras that showed him afterwards just screaming at Vince. He punches him out. So they call this the Montreal Screwjob, And I decided this thing is as Shakespearean as it gets. I mean, you have betrayal, you have, you know, a king. I mean, Vince McMahon is the, you know, I mean, is the king of this fiefdom. You have an ethical, you know, quandary, because it's who is right? Is Vince right? Says, no, it's my promotion. You became big because I gave you the opportunity to do so. Brett says, I'm the star. I'm the reason I put butt in seats for your promotion. It was my hard work, my putting my body on the line, my developing this persona. So to me, if that's all the makings of a great, you know, where there's going to be lots of dialogues and monologues of each one, you know, making their case as to, and I wrote it all in Shakespearean language. So I'm still trying to see, I mean, obviously nothing's happening on Broadway, nothing's being produced, but I'm trying to get some of my old wrestling friends, you know, who are big stars, even though they're retired or semi-retired, attached, just like in a film. If you get a major guy attached to it, it's going to attract other people.
Yeah, for sure.
So if I get, yeah, so if I get Sting, or God help me, if I can get like, no, The Rock, who obviously is a huge star, because I don't know how many wrestlers could actually do the dialogue. I mean, because it's huge chunks of monologues, you know, in Shakespearean language, where they have to just sit and just, that it's not easy to do.
No.
So he might do it, because obviously he does have to memorize big hunks of dialogue, you know, for his films. And Sting is actually, he's done some acting. So those are like two of the people. And Mick Foley, so the three people I have in mind would be those three, because they actually have some acting chops. They have the brain that can do it. So we'll see. I mean, I'm trying to get in touch with some of these guys and see what happens. And maybe, you know, since the XFL is done, that was Vince McMahon's thing. And wrestling is obviously doing horribly because of what's going on.
Exactly.
Maybe when things open up, he can be convinced to produce this, even though I don't totally rip on him, because I actually try to show his point of view. No, so, I mean, I don't make him the total bad guy. He has an ending monologue where I think I present the point of view of, hey, you know, it's my promotion. I have the right to determine what happens to the guys that I know that I'm paying, how they're going to go out if they're going out.
Yeah.
So, I mean, we'll see. I mean, I never wrote a play before. This just seemed to, once again, it just kind of wrote itself. I read every Shakespeare play I could to try to get into the iambic pentameter and the verbiage. And there's some great verbs. Like one of my favorite insults that I got that I use in a play is clotpole. You clotpole. I like that word, right?
Yeah. Are you going to use it in your everyday lexicon, though? That's the real question. You walk around calling people clotpoles?
Well, I keep on thinking of Mean Girls. Well, no, fetch is never going to happen. Stop trying to make fetch happen. So I have a funny feeling if I try to make clotpole happen, it's not going to happen. But, well, okay, look, we use it here. You have people that watch and listen. Maybe clotpole will become a thing.
Hey, so, you never know. One day you could be watching a George Clooney movie, and all of a sudden he's got a scene in there with clotpole, and you could say, motherfucker, you did me once. So, hey,
but put it this way, at least with an audience of, well, now two. So if you ever hear George Clooney say clotpole, you know, I know where he got that from.
I'm calling him. I'm calling him up.
So, get us both on your podcast, right? So we can finally duke it out. Damn you, Clooney, you're stealing all my good shit.
It'd be like a Celebrity Fight Club.
Oh, I wouldn't. No, I wouldn't.
So you've done some books, and now you wrote a play, and things just kind of keep moving along. What is next? What can we expect to see or hear from you in the near future?
Well, I would like to make at least one more film. Now, even if things were open now, I don't want to be the filmmaker that just shoots it on a phone. I still want it to be professionally done. So even the cheapest film that I can make is still going to cost money.
Right.
I mean, you still want audio sweetening, you want professional editing, you want all that stuff. And right now, I mean, like everyone else, my investments took a huge hit. I'm not working. I do have at least one more film in me. Rick Schmidt, we've made four films together, you know, the feature filmmaker at Used Car Prices, my mentor that got me in it. We've been talking about another possible film together. So I would like one more film. As far as any other arts, I mean, if I get this play moving, that'll be one more art form. I mean, it's one thing to write it. I would like to see it done, even if it's at some local theater.
Yeah.
I don't know if there's any other entity out there, any art form. I mean, I just will probably go back to either writing another book or hopefully making another film.
Now, do you have a project that's currently in crowdfunding status?
Yes, I have. Like I said, I wrote two books last year. I have a book. Once again, it's going to be the third book in the trilogy that I wrote about myself.
Okay.
It takes place in the 7 years I lived in Denver. After I graduated college, I went to NYU for magazine publishing procedures certification for the summer because I wanted to work in the magazine industry. And I ended up homeless for a few weeks, living on a park bench in New York City, got an interview with the largest magazine distributor in the world, and ended up moving to Denver, getting a job with a three-state territory, company car and expense account. And so my 20s were spent in Denver, from 21, 22 to 29. And there's some symmetry because my best friend in college is the one that got me interested in magazines because he got me working for the school newspaper. That's in Flipping Point. Once again, a weird thing. I passed his room in the middle of the night because I had to go to the bathroom. His door was open. And he called me in. He says, hey, maybe you can give me some hand on the school newspaper. What do you think? I ended up working for the school newspaper. Loved that. Caught on to his love of magazines. Decided that's what I want to do. So then I ended up in Denver, got married, divorced, had all kinds of very, very, really, really great. I thought they were my salad days because, once again, you're in your 20s. Denver was a great place to be. From 79 to 86, except for one thing. In 1980 is when the movie Urban Cowboy came out, and all of a sudden Denver raised, hey, we're the West, and every bar became a country bar, and everyone had the mechanical bull, and if you wanted to get laid, you had to knew how to country swing, you had to ride the goddamn bull. But that's what I wrote the delightful Denver doldrums about. Like some other weird things happened. My first girlfriend, when I moved to Denver, committed suicide and named me a note.
Oh.
And then I found that out when her mother called me.
Oh, man.
I broke up with her because I met her. She was like 7 years older than me, and she had a 10-year-old kid. She got married really, really young, had this child really, really young, and her husband was serving in Vietnam. He had done three tours, had a chance to rotate back home, chose to do another tour. And she goes, he could go back to me and his son, his young son, or he could fight in Vietnam again. And that completely flipped her out. They got divorced. So when we met, and I'm 22, just moved to Denver, and she wants a father for her son. She wants, and I'm not ready for that. So I told her, I said, I this isn't what I want. It's not what I can't do this right now. I'm not the right guy for you. So I thought then, and I still think now, that was the right thing. And that was, I got mentioned in the note. Years later, another thing, I won't go too much detail, because I want people to actually, since you mentioned the crowdfunding, which I am grateful for, and I want people to help me with that and then buy the book, is I actually was involved in a plot to kill someone. I'm not proud of it. If there's any bad karma in my life, where I wrote Flipping Point, I can certainly point a finger to that I actually agreed with this yuppie from hell guy that I met. This plot to kill this guy. This guy was a complete and total scumbag, but that doesn't mean, you can kill him.
Right.
So it was seven interesting years of my life, and the book ends kind of where it begins. I mentioned my best friend who I passed his room in my dorm, and I worked for the school newspaper. Anyway, we ended up living off campus with my girlfriend at the time, and my college girlfriend was 2 years younger. She was my first girlfriend. Just before I became homeless, she's coming to New York to visit me before she goes to college, to what I'm wearing here, Connecticut College.
Hey.
And she breaks up with me. I think finally something good's going to happen because, the course has ended. I don't have a job. My dad said, you can't come back home to Boston. I said, I paid for your college. I paid for the summer thing. You get a freaking job. Don't come home. So I don't know what I'm going to do. The course has ended. This is when I ended up homeless. My girlfriend's coming. At least I'll see her, and she breaks up with me. So then I get the job, move to Denver, I get married, divorced, and that's when I decided I got to leave Denver. I'm going to move to Florida. I was working for the direct mail company in Denver and transferred to Florida. It was Florida where I read the ad in Rolling Stone. But as I'm moving, before I go to Florida, I want to stop and see my best friend who I got him a job with the same company that I was working for when I first moved to Denver, the magazine distribution job. I had lost touch with them, so every now and again I'd call directory information to try to find him. One day I get his name, that match, and he always uses middle initial. So I match, I get the name, and I call the number up, and a woman answers, and I go, "Hi, I'm looking for this guy, and let me just give you his middle name. It's Exol." I mean, how many people have that middle name? There was a pause, and the woman goes, "Barry?" I go, "Yes." It was my college girlfriend. They had gotten married.
Crazy.
Once again, she's 2 years younger. My best friend and I, we lived in a house with her off campus. My friend and I go to New York City for the summer program. I get a job in Denver. He gets a job in Houston. So when did this thing start to happen? I mean, it obviously happened while we were still in college together.
Sure.
So it kind of ends with Catherine, breaking my heart. My best friend and I going, getting this job, splitting up, me going to Denver. And then I find them in Texas before I go on to Florida. So there's a little bit of symmetry that bookends, my 7 years in Denver. So that's what it's about. My first two books, I've gotten some interest in publishing, but I did self-publish. And because money is a little bit lower now, that's why I decided to crowdfund. And this is obviously the worst time to crowdfund because nobody has money.
Right.
It is crowdfunding on GoFundMe. And like I said, the name of the book is Delightful Denver Doldrums. Even if I don't raise the money, I'm going to do it because I have to see it out now.
Sure.
I mean, I already have the cover designed. It's already gone to it. So I have to see it. If any money comes in, great. Whatever it does is at least will defray some of the costs of self-publishing. If not, I'm going to do it.
Yeah.
So that's out there. Like I said, and for anyone who thinks I stole the name, I kind of did, because we were talking before that, Kurt Vonnegut is one of our favorite authors because he has that type of, those spontaneous type prose. Well, Jack Kerouac is another one of my favorite authors. And he's obviously famous for spontaneous prose. And he wrote a short story just called The Denver Doldrums. So I thought, I can't just steal that because why not? You can't do it. But I said, well, my years in Denver were kind of both. There's doldrums because of a couple of things I mentioned to you about, but there was a lot of great stuff. Like I said, in your 70s and late 70s, early 80s in Denver when you're in your 20s. And so there was a lot of great stuff. So I said, okay, what if I call it The Delightful Denver Doldrums? I borrowed it. I will wear my influences on my sleeve. I don't try to write like them because I've read so much Kerouac and I've read so much Hunter Thompson, another one of my favorite writers, and I've read so much Vonnegut. Yeah, they absolutely influence that type of writing.
Sure.
So that's the style. I don't know how to do anything else. Same with filmmaking. It just seems so natural to have, just say, action and whatever. You're you in the situation we put you in. So if you're acting in one of these films, we're not going to tell you you're doing something else. The situation you're in is going to be different, so which means you're not really acting.
Yeah,
you're going to be you figuring out what you would do in this circumstance. So that's the same way I write, although it is about me. It just goes and however it goes, wherever it goes, that's where it goes.
Yeah. Well, Barry, your life is nothing if not piles of interesting craziness. So I think this has been an awesome conversation. I appreciate you sharing all the cool stuff with me. I'm sure we could probably talk for 9 more hours and just keep going and going and going. But sadly, the clock at some point will run out. So sometime in the near future, maybe we catch back up again on the show, kind of check in on you, kind of how things are going with the crowdfunding. All you guys out there in podcast land, go to the GoFundMe site. Throw millions of dollars Barry's way. George Clooney, I'm going to expect you to contribute to this as well. Just throwing that out there at you. So anything else, Barry, you want to plug before I let you get on with your night?
Well, I do have one other book that I have written that I can't totally mention about. It is a biography of one of the professional wrestlers that I work with. He and I were friends for 31 years, and unfortunately, while writing the book, the friendship ended.
Yes.
It's why you try not to do – that's what happened with my best friend with the radio show. We were friends for 40 years, and because we didn't have a contract, things ended badly, and we tried to stay friends for a year after that, and it didn't work. There was just so much resentment, and that's what happened here. So he actually took the book that I wrote and emailed it to another writer.
Ugh.
And the good news is I found out who that writer was, and I immediately copyrighted the book. I mean, this was not my plan. I mean, I was not trying to steal the book, but I spent a lot of time on it. So this is the first book I wrote about someone else who is a famous, you know, professional wrestler. So that there's hopefully there is a market for that. I wrote it so even if you don't like wrestling, if you read the book, you might want to read it. Anyway, I mean, it's mostly about his childhood because that's the part he wanted to talk about the most.
Yeah.
And he does have a fascinating childhood. So that's coming out. Obviously, I'm not going to mention who he is or the name of the book, but that is a book that's also going to come out, you know, soon. And like I said, if you decide that I'm interesting enough to have me on back, and when I'm ready to talk about it, then I can go into more details about it.
Yeah.
But there could be some interesting, because he has a podcast that I actually set up for him, and he trashed me for 3 episodes straight on the podcast that I named. I got the guy that's helping him produce it. I came up with the music for it, and he used it to completely badmouth me. So even when I'm ready to talk about the book, I'm not going to throw him under the bus. I have no interest in doing that. I mean, he was a very, very good friend. He did help me through a lot of very, very tough times. And it's a sad that it had to end, because when he asked me to write the book, I didn't want to do it just for this reason.
Right.
I mean, he had one writer to try it. That didn't work out. When he asked me, I put him on to a very good friend of mine who's a brilliant writer. It worked and worked and worked until it didn't. And then he said, come on, will you do it? So I did it. I think it's an interestingly, you know, written book. We'll see. And like I said, and it won't be long where I'm able to divulge more. I'm not trying to be coy, because obviously if I could plug it, I would. I just don't want to do so now until
when the time is right, it'll happen.
When the time is right, it's happened.
Yep. So what is the best way if people want to reach out to you, send you a howdy, find out more about what you do? How do they get a hold of you?
Well, since I'm an old fart, I am on Facebook. I know, so Barry Norman, and my avatar is Malcolm McDowell in A Clockwork Orange.
Nice. Right.
So, I mean, yeah, so right. And also Video L, my brothers. So that would be the easiest way. You know, in other words, the GoFundMe thing is there, some other things. I mean, so that's the easiest way for someone to find out more about what's going on and things like that. If they think I'm interesting, friend me. I haven't hit my 5,000 limit yet, because these days, with all the political discourse, for every friend you make, you end up losing 2 more.
There you go.
So it's kind of good. A lot of them, they'll kind of self-eliminate.
Yeah.
So there's that. I mean, I try not to do that on that, but it's kind of hard, because things are really, really, as I'm sure everyone knows, very polarized. And I mean, I like it to connect with people I went to high school and college with, and people, if they're interested in my books or other things about me. Obviously, I have a lot of people involved in film, a lot of other filmmakers, you know, actors, things like that. People, so you have that type of community. But 99% of what's on social media these days is that's a thing. So
there you go. Well, once you get that new book ready to talk about, let's make that happen, because I know who you're talking about. And
yep.
Let's just say some people get the inside scoop, just saying. But yeah, I'm excited. I wanted to dig into that today, but we just couldn't make that happen. So we'll do a follow-up at some point. We'll dig into that. Barry, thank you so much for hanging out with me today on Misery Point Radio. Appreciate your time, and good luck to you on all your projects, brother.
Thanks, Mike. Thank you for having me on. It's been a blast.
And of course, thanks to all of you, everyone out there in the podcast wasteland, for joining us for today's paranormal experience. Special shout out to Stephen Joyner for blackmailing Barry into coming on the show against his will. Don't worry, Barry. Steve gave me his word he wouldn't release those pictures. Well, at least until the offers get high enough. At which point, I'm owed a cut. Don't forget that, Steve. Besides, it's not like the stuff you're doing in those pictures is illegal in every state. You'll be fine. For a while, anyways. As always, if you like what I'm doing here on Misery Point Radio, please subscribe to the show on all the platforms. iTunes, Google Podcasts, iHeartRadio, Spotify, TuneIn, and check out the show on Spoilerverse. That's www.spoilerverse.com/Misery Point Radio. And do me the solid, follow the show on all of those social media platforms, the Book of Faces, the Instagrams, the Tweety Twatty Place, and YouTube. So if you do that for me, I'll be forever grateful, and I'll talk to you next time on Misery Point Radio.